For this is your goal. invite the congregation to stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. I invite the congregation to kneel. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite the congregation to stand. Behold my servant whom I uphold, my chosen in whom my soul delights. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now, therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. For his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Behold my servant whom I uphold, my chosen in whom my soul delights. In peace let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, at the baptism of Jesus in the Jordan River, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized in his name faithful in their calling as your children and inheritors with him of everlasting life, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite the congregation to be seated. The Old Testament reading for the baptism of our Lord, the first Sunday after his Epiphany, is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Joy has dawned upon the world, promise from creation, God's salvation. Now unfurled, hope for every nation. Not with fanfares from above, not with scenes of glory, but a humble gift of love, Jesus born of sounds of wonder fill the sky with the songs of angels as the mighty Prince of Life shelters in a stable and that set each star in place, shape the earth in darkness, in and out. Mother's breast, vulnerable and helpless. Shepherds bow before the Lamb, gazing at the glory, gifts of men from distant lands, prophecy the story. Gold, a king is born today, incense, God is with us. Earth is dead, we make a way, by his blood give we us. Son of Adam, son of heaven, as a ransom, reconciling God and man, rise our mighty champion. What a Savior, what a friend, what a glorious mystery. Once a baby in Bethlehem, now the Lord comes.
The epistle for the baptism of our Lord is from the sixth chapter of St. Paul's epistle to the Romans. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we, who died to sin, still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The congregation to stand for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. John the Baptist appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We confess our most holy faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. I invite the congregation to be seated as we sing our hymn of the day, 405, "To Jordan's River Came Our Lord." be unto you mercy and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Happy Epiphany. Epiphany. The season that usually falls in January, always falls in January, and possibly part of February. It's that season of the church year that you find that you're automatically in, and you wonder what the word epiphany means. At least we did when I was little. Yet even in recent times, the word epiphany has taken on new meaning as people come up with a great idea. It's sort of like a word like eureka or a segue or some other thing. I think it was Oprah Winfrey that rediscovered the word epiphany. I had an epiphany the other day. Well, epiphany has a very definite meaning. It means the appearance as God. There was a king of Antioch between the Testaments at the time of the Maccabees. His name was Antiochus, and he was Antiochus IV, but he felt that he needed to make plain to his empire and to the world that he was God, and so he was called Antiochus Epiphanes. Christmas, of course, is an epiphany of God. God in the flesh, our Lord Jesus Christ. And so that's why there is a very close relationship between Christmas and Epiphany. Epiphany is part of the Christmas cycle, you might say. As the Easter cycle begins with Lent, and then, of course, the cycle of the church begins after the celebration of Pentecost. It is, to all our knowledge, the earliest day in which the church celebrated the birth of Jesus. So before the time when it was established that the church would celebrate Christmas on the 25th of December, they celebrated Christmas on the 6th of January. And that's why in reverent biographies of Jesus that they say that he was born on January 6th in the year 1 AD. Of course, that was such an important day, and it's wonderfully, probably, as we would might say, the 12th day of Christmas, or the 12th day of Christmas was the day before. Epiphany, of course, is now celebrated as the coming of the three wise men, the three kings. The Eastern Church calls it the Christmas of the three kings, the Gentiles' Christmas. Because they, of course, were the ones that would come to his light and kings to the brightness of his rising in fulfillment of the scriptures. The first Sunday after Epiphany, which is today, is also the day after Epiphany. Sometimes it falls. And we now can celebrate Epiphany together as the time in which we take to heart the appearances of Jesus as God's chosen Savior, a witness to the world and a witness to all of us for our salvation. Thinking of his baptism, we apply the doctrine of his baptism as we look at our epistle for today, where the Apostle Paul argues and teaches. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin, for he who has died is freed from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer is master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not be master over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. So the Apostle Paul applies Jesus' baptism to us as a separation from sin, much in the same way as he would want to name any specific type of understanding of what is a separation. What is a more drastic separation from people to people, or people to God, as death is. Death, of course, is the penalty for Adam's original sin. Notice right at the beginning of creation, it points out, it kind of has a reference, a connection of the Holy Spirit and water, as the Spirit, like a female bird is hovering over her nest, so the Holy Spirit hovers over the primeval deep, God creating order in the universe. And God said, "Let there be light," and he separated the light from the darkness. So also with holy baptism is in the manner in which God separates us from the sinful world and applies to us what Jesus has done by his baptism, by his life, and by his resurrection, because all of that is going on at the same time. Adam, of course, was the one who made everyone a sinner except Jesus. It's kind of like the way in which anyone who is born into the human race from the time of Adam is someone that is dead spiritually, dead to any type of relationship with God. We were born dead into this world. And so then the Lord Jesus coming and beginning his ministry of redemption has himself baptized by John the Baptist, by his cousin. And, of course, as we know, manifested something spectacular. The heavens were ripped open, and the Spirit of God, as the life-giving dove, descended upon him and stayed with him. And the voice of the Father, the Heavenly Father, saying, "You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." There you have baptism established for us, that you are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. If we look at the record of humanity from creation to judgment day, we can see that the law does a vital service for us as the Word of God, in which it shows us our sin and our need of Christ, our need to be baptized into his name, to be in Christ. The law also, of course, protects those in the world who are in need of protection, the innocent. And in a sense, it's like the law is like a helpful fence that's put around people and whom God wishes to protect. But you have a problem, because the law is unable to save. And that's one of the points that the apostle makes in his epistle, where he says that we are not under the law, we are under grace. Because it is only by the good news of the gospel of Christ that we are rescued from death, from the death we have in being born into this world, and also the death of our own sin. But of course, here the question that the apostle deals with is the idea that if sin caused God to bring his Son into the world and to bring more grace into the world, even as the apostle rejoices that where there was sin, there is even more grace, which is the comforting knowledge of the gospel that there is no possible sin that you could have committed that cannot be covered by the blood of Jesus. And so the idea, again, is especially with that sinful nature. The sinful nature likes to use the law in a different way. It likes to use the law to tell you that you have to earn your salvation. The sinful nature is also there that just loves the gospel with the idea, well, if Jesus suffered and died and brings forgiveness for all sins, then we can sin as much as we like. Because God loves sinners and God wants to cover all sin. But as the Apostle Paul says, that there has been a separation. In the same way as God separated the light from the darkness, so he separates those who are baptized into Christ from sin itself. How can we who died to sin live any longer in it? And let me say this, that our sinful nature has no right to the gospel. Our sinful nature is a part of us, probably, like you might say, a gangrene member that needs to be cut off and cut out. Unfortunately, it's impossible for that to happen in this life, and it is wrong for the people of God to demand that of people that they be purely holy, or even to suggest that it's possible in this life for us to be perfect. Because we still carry that sinful nature with us from the cradle to the grave. And it is only through death that it's finally dealt with. The gospel is only for that new man or new woman or new girl or new boy that is created in baptism. It is what creates faith in our hearts by the power of God's Spirit. It is that light that God created. The uncreated light of forgiveness and salvation that comes through our Savior Jesus Christ. And so, as the apostle says, Jesus died on the cross to take away all of our sins, and Jesus also rose again from the dead for our justification. And so, Jesus is our righteousness, our justification, as we see in 1 Corinthians 1:30. He is our sanctification. He is our everything as far as our relationship to God is concerned. And so we can say that in the righteousness of Christ, we have everything that we need for everlasting life. And so everything that Jesus is and did for us is something that is applied to us. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ, that nothing matters but a new creation, that we are newly created in Christ so that we might do good works, much in the way in which the golden words, for by grace have you been saved through faith and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. And that those golden words are continued. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works that God determined that we should walk in them. Kind of loosely quoting it. But the point is that God makes us a new creation through holy baptism. God makes us into different people, much in the same way as Jesus told his disciples that you make disciples by baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Newly created in Christ as saints and those who are heirs of everlasting life. So the apostle reminds us that it is only after we have received the forgiveness of all of our sins. The sinful nature wanted to get us to think in a terrible, deadly opinion that we should earn our salvation, that our good works are needed by us in order to make ourselves right with God. The truth of the matter is that God does not need our good works. And we do not need our good works, because Jesus has performed all of the good works necessary for us to have everlasting life. Trusting in Him, we have a sufficient ransom and a sufficient righteousness that allows us to stand boldly on the day of judgment, when all those who have not known Christ are going to be very ashamed and be very sad indeed. Because we trust in one who is able to provide a righteousness which is sufficient to save us. So what about our good works? After all of that, after receiving Christ through baptism, after being taught God's holy will for us, the Spirit empowers us through the gospel to do good works or good deeds. Who needs them? Your needy neighbor that needs your works. That's one of the things that Martin Luther did when he was trying to still the time of the the uproar in Wittenberg, where some of the preachers didn't have it right. People like a fellow by the name of Andrew Karlstadt, who said that we have to tear down everything. Luther said that that Christianity is not only faith in Christ, which of course gives us everything we need for eternity, but it is also love. It is also that we give ourselves to our neighbor, and that he, of course, is the one that needs those good works of love, even as they are witnesses of the fact that we do belong to Christ. And as he says, as Christ died, so we should always say to ourselves, our baptism puts us into Christ, so our baptism is when we are crucified to Christ, that we are put to death in Christ, that we are buried with Christ, but in the same way that we are raised in Christ, much in the same way as we confess in the Catechism, where it says, what does such baptizing with water mean? It means that the old Adam, the old Eve in us, should by daily contrition and repentance be drowned and die together with all sins and evil lusts, and the new man and the new woman come forth who shall live before God in righteousness and purity forever, in accordance with God, what God says, we are buried with Him. So we have been separated from sin. But of course, as I said, there is still that sinful nature. But that is dealt with each day when, as we say that we should, by daily contrition and repentance, drown that old nature, that it may die together with all sins and evil lusts. So there's always a dying and being raised again, a separation from sin. And in this way, Christ, through His baptism, which is also our baptism, transforms us into new creations. And so as we celebrate today as an epiphany, one of the many epiphanies of our Lord Jesus Christ, as He was baptized in the Jordan River, so it also, baptism is also for us an epiphany that we are the children of God and destined by God's love to share in the divine nature of immortality. That we too, it is an epiphany for us, because on the day of judgment, it is all of us as the church who will be shown to all of the principalities and powers of the universe as God judges the world. Behold my beloved, behold my bride, that I have redeemed with my precious blood, and whom I have also nourished and strengthened through the holy sacrament of my body and my blood. And so we, as those who are shown to the world, because our good works also provide the witness that we are children of God, so we also are to show by the grace of God and through the gospel and the sacraments the way for anyone else, whoever will believe, to trust in Him and to be reborn by the power of His Spirit. May God grant it for Jesus' sake. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. This time I invite the congregation to stand as we sing, "What Shall We Bring to the Lord," as our offerings are brought forward. I invite the congregation to stand for the prayer of the faithful. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, you revealed your Son in the wondrous Epiphany in the Jordan. So also you have revealed your name and blessing to us in holy baptism, declaring us your beloved heirs. Grant that we may daily die to sin and rise to newness of life, living with joy as your baptized children. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, bless all places where your people teach and learn. And to that end, we pray a blessing upon this holy house, also upon our preschool and those who labor in it and those who are brought to it as a place in which your people teach and learn. Guide our director, guide our teachers, guide students in parochial schools and Christian institutions of learning. That together we would marvel at your creation and appreciate the depth of your wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, grant that all those baptized into Christ would receive the boldness of your servant John the Baptist to lead faithful and pure lives in this world, ever mindful of our promised heavenly inheritance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty Lord, your Son, Jesus, is the Christ and the true King of this world. Grant great humility to the rulers of the nations, to the President of the United States, the Congress, the judiciary, the Governor of the State of Missouri and the legislature, and all of those appointed to serve in government, that they would submit to the preaching of his holy word for the sake of their own souls and for the good of your holy people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give comfort and relief to those who are sick, depressed, tired, confused, or in any need. Especially, we pray for the family of Wilbert Webb Hain, who has departed this life a week before and received Christian burial this past Friday. Pray that you would be with his wife Sharon and his children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and his many friends who are saddened by being parted from him. We also pray for those that are on our parish prayer list, for Dale, Nancy, Perry, Joyce, Ed, Michael, Jane, Michael, Andrea, Sarah, Celia, Anne, Robin, Tom, Bernadette, Cindy, George, Bonnie, Stefan, Doug, Ruth Ann, Janice, Helen, Evelyn, Sharon, Ron, Ruth Ann, Ruth, Mel, Sharon, Dan, Billy, and those whom we name before you silently in our hearts. Watch over all expectant mothers and their children, especially in our fellowship. We ask that you would be with Rachel as she carries her child, that they may have a safe delivery and be brought also to the life-giving waters of holy baptism. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, in holy baptism you have opened the hearers to your children. Grant, the heavens, rather, you have opened. Grant that all those baptized into your Son would worthily receive the heavenly feast of his body and blood for their salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, you have made us your own people by baptism and granted us your Holy Spirit to confess Christ in word and deed. We remember with thanksgiving those who went before us, who passed the faith on to us, and who now rest in Christ from all their labors. Since we have died with Christ through baptism, grant that we would be raised with him also. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty Father, as your Holy Spirit hovered over the face of the deep, you uttered your word and the world was created. In the waters of holy baptism, you have spoken your name, our names, and declared us righteous. You have drawn us to Jesus, the light of life, and saved us. Let his light now shine through us that others may see our good works and give glory to you through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now we celebrate the Lord's Supper together as we look in our bulletin to the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For what had been hidden from before the foundation of the world, you have made known to the nations in your Son. In him being found in the substance of our mortal nature, you have manifested the fullness of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Blessed are you, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed are you. Before the foundation of the world, you chose us to be your children. You have liberated us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your dear Son, the very image and reflection of your glory. For him, the universe was made. In him, we have received redemption and forgiveness of sins. Gathered in his name, according to his salutary precept, we pray the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night on which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
O Lamb of God, who takes away the whole world's sin, have mercy. O Lamb of God, grace to us that we from sin may be free. And sin shall be
I invite the congregation to stand as we sing the Nunc Dimittis.
How then our servants grow in peace, salvation have we seen here. The Gentiles died for Israel, born in these Savior most dear. Raise, raise a song on high above.
Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament, and we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Go forth with his blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Congregation will be seated as we sing hymn 394, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise. to all of you, especially our visitors this morning. We're so pleased that you're able to be with us. Please enter your name and your attendance record into the books, the attendance books on the aisle side of the pews, and also enter your name in the guest register in the narthex, the vestibule of the congregation. The members of the church that have not registered online, we hope that you would maybe take the time to enter your name in the attendance books as well. At least after this service, in a few minutes, members of the church will gather up here to take down the Christmas decorations. So if you have a minute or two to come and give us a hand, we'd really appreciate it. Also, tomorrow is our church council meeting. I encourage all members of the council to be there. And also take note, in the bulletin it's reported that the Ladies Guild will have their Bible study begin on the Tuesday evening, January 16th at 6:30. You are given information in the bulletin as to obtaining the study book. And probably call Cindy Heitman if you have any questions. At least at this time, I would really like to thank our own Steve Kohlmeier for being here to bless us with the accompanying music, which is a blessing to our worship, and also our beloved cantor, Raymond Bishop, as well, and to Daryl Weshey for assisting with communion. May the Lord bless your week and keep you safe in his tender care. Thank you.